Before we begin, let's go ahead and open up in prayer. Dear Lord, I just want to ask that you guide our hearts and our minds tonight. Help us to see your word. Help us to be able to analyze ourselves and to see, is there anything going on in our life that is a stronghold, something that's there that maybe we don't recognize the way that we should. Help us, Lord, to be able to do like the Apostle Paul says here in this passage, to tear down these strongholds in our life so that you can live through us more effectively. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you would, in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, we're going to read the first six verses here. It says, "Now I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present, with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some which think of us as if we walk according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." So here the Apostle Paul is looking at some strongholds that really have manifested themselves in the Corinthian church. And Joy was telling me that, I guess, in the ladies' Bible study, y'all kind of mentioned some strongholds, had no idea. Like, we didn't coordinate this, okay? This is where we're at in 2 Corinthians. That's how all that. And she told me a little bit about it, but she's like, "Oh, you're doing that tonight?" And she mentioned a comment as I was walking out the door, so I'm like, I didn't even get to hear everything that she said, so I don't know. You may hear some things repeated. But one of the things that kind of drove my thinking on strongholds it's been actually a few years, and this has just been a developing theme in my mind, is that I was taking a college class, and they were studying archaeology. And one of the things that they did is they dug up this city in Israel called of Dan, the city of Dan. And one of the things that they found there is it was a worship center, and it looked, the city of Dan looked just like the temple area of Jerusalem. Everything they did was the same. They found the same type of bones. They found the same type of temple, the same type of structure. Now, this is what's important to know. Look in First Kings with me. In 1 Kings chapter 12, in verse 26. First Kings chapter 12, verse 26, and we're going to read through 31. It says, "And Jeroboam said in his heart, Now shall the kingdom return to the house of David, if this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem. Then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah. And they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold." Now, these two calves of gold, Jeroboam is reaching all the way back into a problem that Israel had when they came out of Egypt. When they came out of Egypt and they're in the wilderness, they had Aaron build them a golden calf. And when they did that, Aaron stood up and said, "Behold the gods who brought you out of Egypt." Okay? That's what Aaron told people. "These are your gods." Okay? The golden calf, all the other things around there. Look what Jeroboam says here in just a second. "And said unto them, It is too much for you to go to Jerusalem." He's like, I built this for you. I made your gods. It's too hard for you to go all the way to Jerusalem. That's a long walk for you guys. I've got something that's a lot closer for you." He says, "O Israel, which brought thee..." Oh, I turned too fast. It says, "Behold your gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And he set one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan, and this thing became a sin. For the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan, and made a house of high places, and made priests of the lowest of the people, which were not of the sons of Levi. So Jeroboam, he makes this worship facility. Everything that they did was just like they did in Jerusalem. Jerusalem, they were serving the Most High God. And Dan, they were serving a golden calf. But the people could not tell the difference between what was in Jerusalem and what was at Dan. Does that make sense? Jeroboam made a stronghold in the life of Israel. And the scripture says it became a sin to them. The thing is that they couldn't tell a difference between the God in Jerusalem and the God that they served in Dan. They couldn't tell the difference. Was there a difference? There was a major difference. One was an idol, and the other one was the deliverer, was the Savior. But because the stronghold had been built for them, and it was convenient for them, they accepted it, and they couldn't tell the difference. They didn't know it was a stronghold in their life. They thought, this is just the way things are. This is the way it must be. The king said it is. He says it's okay. That's what we're going to do. I mean, everything about it. They made it this grand thing. Look what that they found there. It says this, that the ancient city complex was surrounded by a 50-acre massive rampart over 175 feet thick. Leading up to the gate was a paved road with a rectangular structure against the northern tower wall, which the researchers assume was used for a king's throne or a cultic statue. And the city maintained its life. When the city maintained its life, the residents would enter through a huge mud brick gateway, which consisted of two towers. One was 16.5 feet wide each, joined by a completely intact mud brick 8-foot arch. It was discovered in the summer of 1979. So they've recently discovered this stuff within the past, 45 years or so. The gateway complex, part of the ancient Dan massive city defenses, was composed of three arches: an exterior or eastern arch facing the outside of the city, a center arch, and an interior or western arch. Basically, what this thing did is it looked awesome. You know, people would show up there and they said, "We have worshiped God." That's what they did. They would call that golden calf, that's God. Just like Jeroboam said, this is your God who brought you out of Egypt. And they would tell the same stories. They would use the same terminology. They didn't know the difference. But whenever you start defining the terms, there was a big difference. Okay? There was a stronghold, false worship that Jeroboam set up. Now, what you're going to find out in strongholds that happen in your life is the same thing. It's a big lie, and you believe it. You believe it. And when you believe it, to you, it's this awesome thing. How can it be wrong? It looks so right. How can it be bad when it seems so good? And that's what was going on at Dan. And anyway, that's the stronghold that Jeroboam built at Dan to deceive the people, and they fell for it. Hook, line, and sinker. And that's what the devil does in all of our lives. He tries to build strongholds just like that. Massive things, almost impenetrable. And you believe it's good. You believe it's okay. You believe that that's just the way it is. You don't know the difference until you begin to analyze your life through God's eyes. That's the only way that you're going to be able to see it. That's the only way. And when you see it, then you can begin the very, very, very difficult work of bringing down the stronghold. But you have to do it God's way. You're not going to be able to do it your way. It's too strong. It's too powerful. You're going to fail. In fact, most of the time, you're not even going to recognize the actual stronghold. You're going to be paying attention to the other things, the symptoms of the disease versus really what's the cause of it. You know, that's what physicians do most of the time now, is they just try to make you feel better about what's going on in your life. That's what the devil wants to do. If you discover that you're doing something in your life that's a sin, and you're like, I'm going to deal with this, and I want to feel better about this sin, and that's really, it looks like a sin to you, but it's really more of a symptom of a worse sin, of a stronghold that's in your life. And what did 1 Kings say? That stronghold became the sin. Now, there was a lot of things that they were doing, okay? There was a lot of things that were symptoms, but that was the sin. Does that make sense? That's strongholds, all right? So now that we've got that defined, you know, you look at that paper, that's gonna give you an idea about something, because I want to show you something else. How would you know if there's a stronghold in your life? Can you recognize it? Would you be willing to accept it if you've discovered that there was a stronghold in your life? You know, that's the problem that a lot of people have. They don't want to admit that that's a stronghold. They're going to say, well, that's just the way God made me. Look, I get God made all of us a certain way. Okay? You are designed a certain way. And when you were born into a fallen world. And you have a sin nature. All of us have a sin nature. But everybody's sin nature does not lean in the same direction. Does that make sense? You can be born a certain way with a certain prerogative towards a specific type of sin. Everybody's not going to have the same symptom of that sin. Does that make sense? Some people, they're going to tend toward, their sin will tend towards whatever. I don't even want to start naming things. If you think that, if you discover something as you go through that list, like, oh, I do have something going on. People do lean towards a certain type of sin. You know, not everybody that's going to become, you know, homosexual or an adulterer or a gossip or a blasphemer or a thief or a murderer. You know, not everybody does all of those things. But whenever you start looking at the source, they're all from the same sin. They're all the same. And that's why we, as believers, true believers, we don't look at one person's sin and say, oh, that's a bad sin, and then look at this one like, oh, that one's not as bad. In God's eyes, they're all bad. He hates them. They're gross. They're disgusting. And God wants you to have that attitude about sin, period. It's gross, disgusting. God wants you to be holy because He is holy. He wants you to be like Him. And until you get that mindset of God to say, sin is gross, it's disgusting, it makes Him puke, it makes me puke, even if I'm the one who does it. Sometimes I make myself sick. That's okay. That's a good sign that God is working on your life. And you recognize there is a problem. God, would you help me be able to tear down the stronghold? Would you recognize it if you have that in your life? Do you want to? Whether or not you want to or not, I'm going to show you how to recognize it, okay? And I'll let you deal with the issue yourself or get some counsel later on. But Galatians chapter 5 is where we're going to go next. I want to show something to you. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22. Says, but the fruit of the Spirit, I want you to know, this tells you how God is working good in your life, okay? So I'm going to read what's good in a person's life, and then we're going to talk about how can I use this scripture to recognize a natural stronghold, okay? So Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And you may wonder, well, what in the world does that have to do with strongholds? Here's what it has to do. If you lack any of the fruit of the Spirit in your life, that's a sign there's a stronghold. Does that make sense? If you look at the kind of the questions there, you see those questions there? It says that I despise this. That's the opposite of love, right? I really, really hate something. I despise this. Now, I understand that question. Maybe you despise sin. That's not a stronghold, okay? That's not a stronghold. But if you say, I despise white people, that's a stronghold. That's prejudice. I despise Russians. That's a stronghold. It's prejudice. Do what? So you see where I'm going with that? I despise Republicans or Democrats. All right? There's a stronghold that's either there or being built. Does that make sense? You may not agree with them, but to have hate in your heart, there's a problem. Does that make sense? That's what I'm trying to help us understand. To recognize the stronghold, that there is a stronghold there. Because the devil's going to be deceptive. He's going to build these things up. You're not going to recognize it. How can you recognize it? There's a lack of fruit. Blank consumes me with negative thoughts. You see how that's going to take away from the peace? You can't have peace because when you think about this, you have negative thoughts about it. You know, when you wake up in the morning and you know you're flipping through your phone and all of a sudden you start having negative thoughts about something, you may actually have a... I'm sitting here, I'm stepping on my own toes because I just thought of something. I'm like, you know, maybe there's kind of an addiction building of a social media. Social media make you have negative thoughts. Well, it's either a stronghold or it's one building. Maybe it's just part of it. Maybe it's a symptom of something even worse. What's going on there? Does it cause you to have negative thoughts? There's something there. Does that make sense? Is it bad to have a negative thought? No. It's not a sin. But there's a source. Because God doesn't want you to have negative thoughts. He wants you to have peace. He wants you to be able to see the world burning down around you. It's like, it's all good. He's got this. Now, most of us have trouble with that. I'm one of those. I'm like, man, I'm stepping on my own toes. But you see, you don't even recognize you have those things. You don't recognize that there's a problem. You're like, that's just the way it is. That's the way it's supposed to be. Everybody around me has the same type of things going on. We all have some issues. We all have some strongholds in our life that God wants to pull down. Does something cause you to be afraid? Is there anything that makes you afraid? You got a stronghold or in one building. Does something make you lose your patience? Are you intolerant towards something or someone, a specific group? There's a stronghold. I struggle to be nice when this happens or whatever. Blank causes me to have a lack of faith. Now, a lack of faith is when you trust yourself or others more than God. During these moments, I push everyone away and neglect prayer and reading the Bible. Does that ever happen? There's a stronghold. And I've been there, you know. Even as a leader in the church, there's been times that, you know, I just don't want to be around anybody. I don't pray right. I don't read my Bible. I just kind of go through the motions of life. There's a stronghold. The devil is trying to build a stronghold in my life. Or maybe there already is one, and I don't even see it. I don't recognize it. Something causes me to lose self-control. Do you just have violent outbursts? Or maybe you eat uncontrollably? Whatever. Something causes you to not be able to control something that you're doing. Okay? If you ever lose self-control, that's something that's an opposite of the fruit of the Spirit. There's a stronghold there. And if you dig deep, you'll find it. Most people don't want to. They don't want to go in that direction. Any questions so far? Are y'all tracking with me? Is it kind of making sense? I know this is deep teaching, but if you would be willing to analyze yourself, I mean, I put these questions together right before I came, so you know, I didn't really get a chance to spend a lot of time digging, you know, really considering them. They were just kind of what came to my mind first, you know, after I prayed to God, give me the right questions, you know, and I put them down. But I think that they will help you really dig a little bit deeper inside your life to say, is there something underlying why I have these type of feelings and emotions and personality traits? Something's there. Would I be willing to receive what God's got for me? Do I want to pull down a stronghold in my life? Do I want to recognize those and do something about it? So, y'all want to know how to bring down a stronghold? The Bible tells us, okay? The Bible tells us. Look in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 7. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 7. It is not Ephesians 6, 7. I think it's Galatians 6, 7. I don't know why I said Ephesians 6, 7. Anyway. Huh. Anyway, it's the sword. Oh, goodness. I think it's, is that back in 2 Corinthians? That's
what is the verse saying? What's the key word?
The sword of the Spirit. I think it's 5, 7. Is it 5, 7, 6, 7?
Ephesians 6, 17.
6:17. Okay, I left off my one. Oh, goodness. All right. 6:17. See, sometimes I make mistakes. I knew it was in there somewhere. And it says to take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. If you want to be able to bring down a stronghold, you have to take the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. You're not going to make it without your Bible. Okay? And you've got to know it. That's why it's important. You know, a lot of times, you know, when I'm speaking to you and teaching you, I'll use frequent verses. Have y'all noticed that? I use frequent verses because the more you hear it, the more you're going to learn it. You're going to remember that. I want that. I do that on purpose. I could pick 100 different type of verses that will be brand spanking new to you. But I don't know if that would do you as much good as the repetition of one verse that whenever you need it the most, all of a sudden it comes back to you and you're like, how do I even know that verse? Well, it's because you had this, you were under a preacher that believed that the more you heard a verse, he believed that you would remember it. And that you would begin to be able to quote it too. And it would be something that whenever you need it the most, that it would come to the surface and give you strength to get through that moment. That's why. I know it maybe it sounds childish, but, you know, I've worked with a lot of kids. It helps the kids. I'm like, if it'll help kids, maybe it'll help adults. And you know what? It's helped me, you know? And Jesus even said, you know, it's if you're going to come to God, you must come like a little child. You know, when you overthink things and you overcomplicate it, it doesn't help anybody. However, if you just come to Him with that child's heart, get that Word of God in there and believe God's Word is able. The Scripture says that it's like a double-edged sword piercing to the dividing of the bone and the marrow. Now, I don't know how, I've never seen something that sharp. I don't know how you divide bone and marrow. Kaylin's just did a bones class. I don't know. How do you divide bone and marrow? I don't know. But it's really, really sharp. That's what it does. And God says, if you're going to tear down a stronghold, you need something that sharp that can dissect it the right way. And then I started thinking of, during my military days, you know, if I'm going to fight a fire, that if I'm going to put out a fire, Has anyone ever fought a fire before? Yeah. What happens if you spray, if you spray at the top of the fire? Nothing. Nothing happens. If you're gonna take out a fire, you have to point. You have to separate the flame from the source, from the fuel. You have to separate it from air and from fuel. If you're gonna bring down something if you're gonna stop a fire, you gotta cut away the air and the fuel. Those two things have to go away. If you're gonna bring down a stronghold, you have to do the same thing. You gotta go for the base. You gotta separate it. So whenever you're gonna put out a fire, you aim at the bottom of the fire, and that's how you put it out. So if you ever have a kitchen fire and you aim at the, if you're aiming at the ceiling, that's not gonna help you at all. You gotta aim at the bottom and work your way up. It must be fought like that. You've got to starve it, you have to suffocate it, and you use the word of God to cut it, to divide that, okay? The word of God is what separates it. Everybody's with me so far? God's word will suffocate it and separate it. You have to know what gives the stronghold its life, okay? You have to know the fuel. You have to know what it breathes, because it's not going to breathe oxygen like a fire. It's going to breathe something else. You've got to know what feeds it, all right? So if you're going to bring it down, some of those things you've got to know. I want y'all to look with me in Ezekiel chapter 16. Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse 49. To kind of give you everybody understands Sodom, right? Anybody not know what Sodom is? The cities that God destroyed with fire and brimstone. Everybody knows that? Nod your head if you know. If you don't know, I'll tell the story. Okay. So it says, "Behold, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom. Pride, fullness of bread, and the abundance of idleness was in her and in her daughters. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy, and they were haughty and committed abomination before me. Therefore, I took them away as I saw good." So God comes into Sodom. Sodom had built up, it was a huge stronghold in the Canaanite area. It was bad news for all those people. And whenever we start analyzing Sodom, we start looking at its sins. What we think are sins. Those are the things that are bad. You know, it was bad that, you know, the men of the city came to Lot's house and wanted to rape his visitors. It was bad that they brought their little children with them to see their performance of this action. It was bad that what they normally did in that city and how they conducted business, all those things, are they sins? They are sins, but they're really symptoms of something even worse. Okay? And Ezekiel, he digs in deep and he says, these are the strongholds in Sodom's life. And it says Israel did the same thing. They built Tel Dan, the city of Dan. The archaeologists dug it up, and it looks just like Jerusalem. The archaeologists couldn't tell the difference. The people living during those times, they didn't know the difference. The prophets would come along and say, there's a difference. But they wouldn't accept that. They wouldn't accept what the preacher was saying. They wouldn't accept what God was saying. They wanted their sin, and they liked it. They're like, we can't tell the difference. It's good. It makes us feel good. Why shouldn't we do it? It looks the same. We act the same. What's the difference? There's a difference. There's a difference. You just can't recognize it because you don't want to. Here, he lists the first one. What's the first one that he listed there? Y'all see that?
Pride.
Pride. What is pride? Somebody talk to me about pride. You ever had pride about something? I know you have. Let me give you my definition of it, since nobody wants to talk. It's thinking you're better than what you really are. Okay? or thinking you should be thought of better or deserving of something better. That's pride. Thinking that you really are better than what everyone else. They just don't appreciate you the right way. That's pride. I've been there. And you know what? God has humbled me. And you know, the whole time I didn't realize that it was even a stronghold in my life. And y'all just don't know how much fixing God had to do on me. This poor guy, God had a tough job. It took him about as much time to fix me as it did Moses. So pride builds up in somebody's life and they're like, I deserve something better than this. You know, God gives you blessings and he takes care of his people, but a person of God doesn't think ever that they deserve it. If you ever start thinking that you deserve anything, there's something building in your life that's not good. And you need to analyze it and say, it's only by the mercies of God that I'm not this. If you are better than that, it's by grace that you're saved from that.
It's only because
he looked down on you and he offered you an invitation and you said yes, and he plucked you up out of that situation and planted you over here. He's the one who did that. If you think you deserve anything better than that, you got pride. Ever. I've even seen this in especially educated people, right? They're like, I've been to school for this long and I'm so much smarter and I've done this and I've got as many degrees as a thermometer and I know stuff. And they've got pride. And I've seen that pride turn them into a false teacher, a false prophet, because they think they know better than the sharp, two-edged sword. And that's what Sodom's issue was too. So if you ever start thinking that, pride is there. And then there's fullness of bread. Somebody talk to me about fullness of bread. What is that?
Excess food, able to eat all you want.
Gluttony.
Yeah. It is that, and it goes even deeper.
Well, yeah, it's kind of like the idea of being too comfortable.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
It really is you having so much stuff it distracts you from properly serving God.
The guy that had all the grain and built the second bin.
Right.
Prime example of that.
Right, you can accumulate so much stuff that it distracts you from being able to serve God properly. This is kind of a scenario that I've seen in our modern American culture, okay? You know, these guys, they're brought up in church, their parents, they work so hard to provide for their needs and to make sure that they're in church on Sundays and Wednesdays and all these things are in their life, and then make sure that they can go to a good college and they can get a good job so that they can have money, and they get to that point and they're successful and then they start buying stuff and they start getting their career going, and all of a sudden their relationship with the Almighty is deteriorating. And you gotta wonder why. They look like they're doing so good in life. They've got fullness of bread. And what happened in Sodom? They had all the conveniences of life. They had everything that they wanted. God had, he looks down on those cities and they were protected and they were provided for. They had everything. They had no wants, really. They didn't recognize the stronghold that they turned against God. In fact, what they ended up doing is turning into their own pleasures and lusts and fulfilled all the desires of their own flesh. And they just did whatever they wanted, how they wanted, when they wanted, even so much to wanting to take advantage of God's messengers, which was a very deadly mistake for those guys. Does that make sense? Fullness of bread? That's what is there. So however much stuff that you get, if it ever keeps you from being able to serve God the way that He wants you to, you should get rid of it. It's become a stronghold in your life. Is it wrong for you to have stuff? It's not wrong for you to have things. Abraham had things. David had things. But if those things come between you and serving your Creator, it is a stronghold. And most people don't even see it. They're like, I serve God when I'm out there on the lake, you know, fishing. No, you're not. Don't lie. Don't lie. See, it's built on a lie. Strongholds are built on lies, and they believe it. Or they made it up themselves to make themselves feel better.
You got a fish sticker on your boat, you're spreading the gospel, right?
Right. I named my boat Visitation. It's all good. I'm out on visitation. It's all good. The abundance of idleness. What is that one? What is that one?
Too much free time.
Got a lot of free time. Oh, that has gotten a lot of people in trouble. Too much.
The devil's playground.
Yep. Too much time spent not honoring God. They're honoring something, but not God. Here's a kind of a thing that as I was thinking about it, compare how much time you give to God versus other things. See if it even equals 10%. 10% is a tithe. Do you give God 10%? Like if you, let's say you're reading a book. You read a book for 100 minutes. Do you read the Bible for 10? Do you even do that? If you watch TV for 2 hours, do you pray for, 20 minutes? What does it even equal the 10%? And that's just the tithe. Now, I'm just using that as a comparison because most of the time when I ask people, I'm like, how often do you pray? Like, and I've seen it even with adults. I'm like, stand up if I'm not saying y'all do. This isn't for you. But I just want you to think about it because I've had them do that. I'm like, raise your hand if you pray, 5 minutes a day, 5 minutes a week. You go to church, and you'll see that it is really low on how often people actually give to their Creator. They say they believe. Here's the deal. You're gonna do what you really believe. Does that make sense? You're going to do what you really believe. The idleness of time, abundance of idleness, Ezekiel says that was a stronghold in Sodom's life. And then what was that next one that was there? Do y'all see it? About the poor and the needy. What did it say about them?
They didn't feed the poor and the needy.
Yeah, they didn't strengthen the hand of the poor and the needy. Now,
so they have this extra bread and this extra time that they're not doing anything with, and not only that, they didn't even give enough of it to the needy.
Right. Well, the scripture says there to strengthen the hand of them. It's more than just giving, filling a temporary need. It's setting them up where it's kind of like, teaching somebody to fish versus giving them a fish. You're setting them up where they can actually make it on their own. Yeah, initially, yeah, you've got to feed them, but it needs to be more than that. They need to be able to operate on their own. How are they going to get there? And they feel better about just giving out the welfare than they do actually properly training people to do things. And our country should really take note of that because it sure looks like that's what we're trying to do right now. We're just trying to take care of temporary needs and not really taking care of people's actual future and setting them up for true success rather than future downfalls. One of the things that you see through history, if the elite can keep people really poor where they can't really take care of themselves and they absolutely need them to take care of them, they actually become slaves to those people, to the elite. Civilizations have seen that throughout history. So So that's why Sodom did what they did, is that basically what they did is there was an elite class and they made slaves out of the poor. Does that make sense? That's what history has shown, and history tends to repeat itself. Okay. The last one on that list is haughty. What does haughty mean? Somebody from the back row, somebody tell me. Mm-hmm. Haughty.
It's kind
of
like pride, isn't it?
It is like pride. It's a little bit more than pride.
It's like looking down. Right?
Well, it has to do with how you conduct business every day. You know, pride says that you deserve something better. Haughty says that you can do things and get away with it, even if it's wrong. I can get away. The rules don't apply to me. I can do whatever I want because of who I am, or who I think that I am. I think I can get away with it. So really, it's a sin of presumption. They think that they can just get away with it. Y'all, have you ever seen kids think that they can get away with stuff? Yeah, they have a haughty spirit. You know, they scheme and they plan and they're like, I'm going to get away with it. And they tell lies to try, because they think, I deserve to get away with it. They have a haughty spirit. It's they think that they will not be judged for sin, or that you think you can get away with it. They're like, they're not going to do anything to me. They're not going to hold me accountable. You know, that tends to be, kids figure that out about the parents. Does the parent really mean what they say? When they count to three, what's going to happen? And they're judging you. You know, you count to three, and they're looking at you. And you say one, and they still look at you in the same expression, right? You get to two, and they haven't budged. I want you, next time you do that, I want you to recognize the haughty spirit, okay? Haughty spirit's no good. And you know what? When you're counting to three, you know it's no good. And you're about to light on fire. Okay? You're like, I'm counting to three. You get to three. They're waiting. What's gonna happen? Are they gonna go to four? You go to four, you lost the war. I'll just give you something that I did with my guys, you know, when they were little. I would say, I'm gonna count to three. One, and they would look at me. Two, and they wouldn't move a lot of times. And I would get up, and I'd go to the next room, and I'd come back with a surprise. We never got to three. Or if I counted to three, it was while I was swinging. And you know what? It took care of a haughty spirit from a little kid. So by the time most of the time when they got to two, you know, if they weren't paying attention, like, oh, he was counting two and now he's gone, this is bad. Sometimes they didn't recognize it. Y'all remember some of those days? Some of them remember them more than others. Some of them learned from the older ones. The Holy Spirit thinks that they can get away with it, and God's not going to do anything about it. Nobody's going to do anything. I can do whatever I want. God loves me. It doesn't matter what I do. I said my little prayer. I'm going to heaven. It's all good. I got my golden ticket. That is a haughty spirit, and there's a stronghold in that person's life. And they better beware. Because if you won't bring down the stronghold, or if you don't want to bring down that stronghold, it's going to take over your life, and you're not going to know the difference. And you got to wonder sometimes, is there even salvation involved in that person? Are y'all with me? Y'all understand? That was the sin of Sodom. Those were strongholds in Sodom. And I would like to present to you today that I think that those same strongholds make up our lives too. And they can be brought down, but they have to be recognized first. And there's only one way that you can bring them down, and that's through God's word. We're not done yet. There's more on this. Because I need to, I'm sorry, there's one more. They committed abomination. Okay? What is the committing of an abomination? I know this is a...
God in some way, I think.
Yeah, it is blatant disregard for God's law. They know what God said and they don't care. That is abomination. And you can go through the Old Testament and you can read about a ton of different types of abominations. I'm not going to do that for you today. You can ask Google, what are abominations listed in the Bible? And Google will give you a million different abominations. But in a nutshell, it is, oh, look, Google's sitting here talking to me right now. It's listening. My phone keeps listening to me. I'm in trouble now. I'm probably going to be on a blacklist somewhere. They committed abomination, purposely disregarding God's holiness and purpose for your life by doing what you think is right or good, even if it goes against God's word. Some even twist the scriptures to justify what they're doing. They want to be in that whatever so much, even though they know God's word talks against it, that they try to justify it even using the scriptures sometimes. They know it's wrong. They know that there's a problem with it. God says no, and they say, I don't care. That's an abomination. They committed abomination. And I don't know if you've met any people like that yet, but I have. And it's becoming more and more frequent, where they're like, I just don't care what God thinks. And I'm going to do what I want to do, despite what he says. So they go past halting, thinking that they're not going to do anything about it, and they just do it. They're not even going to lie about it. Oh, yeah, that's what I do. I'm even a Christian. Oh, my goodness. You know how you can know if they're totally in the wrong way? They will pronounce their sin before a Christian. right? They'll do it. If you put anything before that classifies you above, before Christ, you have got a haughty and abomination going on it as a stronghold in your life. And there are many that are doing that. And if they watch this, they're going to be mad at me. But you know what? That's God's word. And if you want to recognize strongholds, if you want God to really move in your life, then you'll want those strongholds to come down. You'll want them down. And we'll talk about some of the other things that happen after that. But whenever you bring those down, you will see God in a whole new light. And he will move you in a whole new position of this life. Do you want to bring them down just for a benefit? No, you want to be able to serve God better. That's what it's really about. Bringing down strongholds will absolutely give you a whole new perspective on why you are here at this moment, at this time. Final thoughts. All right. Well, let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, we just want to thank you for your word, and I just ask that you continue to work in our hearts. Let us take some of this stuff home with us and really analyze who we are as people and desire to do those things that are holy and right in your eyes. Lord, would you help us to recognize strongholds in our life and do the business of tearing these things down so that we could serve you better. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ.